All right, go ahead and roll for perception.
I got a 13.
Hey, that's pretty good. With that, you can tell there's some fantasy situations going on. You hear some adult language, and with that, you can tell this podcast probably isn't for kids.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Dungeoncast. I'm Will.
And I'm Brian.
This is the podcast where we talk about everything Dungeons & Dragons, from nature's navigators to nimble ninjas. And today, we're taking you to the Shadowfell.
That is correct.
Prepare yourselves.
I cast fireball. The Dungeoncast. Okay, Brian, so today I'm going to take you to a place of shadow, a place of muted dark skies, a place of despair, of dread, and hopelessness.
Should I roll perception?
Yeah, you better. Probably every fucking 10 feet you move in this place, because this place will fuck your day up. I'm taking you to the Shadowfell. So, what do you know about the Shadowfell, Brian?
That it's kind of like the Feywild in like a way. That it's like, I don't know, is that a history check?
No, that would be, I would call that Arcana check.
Okay, Arcana.
19. Shit, you're rolling. Oh, shit.
The dice knows more
than me,
though.
Apparently, you know a lot about the fucking Shadowfell. The Shadowfell is inherently tied to the Feywild, but it is...
Yeah, that's how I understand it.
Super, super nothing like the Feywild.
Yeah, but
it
like
is super, duper nothing like the Feywild.
The yin to yang, the
kinda.
Other side of the same coin.
Kind of, yeah.
But
so,
I know that it's like another intersecting plane of existence.
Right, it is. So we spoke in the Feywild episode, we talked about how the Feywild is one of the two mirror worlds of the primaterial plane.
Hashtag Fey bullshit.
Yeah, exactly. And the way that came about was when the world was being created, there were bits of materia or material or whatever that were too brightly colored. And that which was too dimly colored,
okay,
if you will. And that's just a metaphor. That's not like literally, although it also is literally that way. And the colorful stuff coalesced and became the Feywild, in a place of, you know.
Grayscale town.
What?
Grayscale town?
What's Grayscale town?
It sounds like that's what the Shadowfell is.
Oh, yes. Very much so. Gotcha. Okay. I'm like, the Feywild's not Grayscale town. What are you talking about?
Oh, yeah. The Shadowfell's Grayscale town.
The Feywild is very very magically inherent, you know, very colorful, very flamboyant, very full of life, very vibrant, very saturated. The Shadowfell is a dismal place that is incredibly colorless.
I dare say drab.
Very, very drab. Drab to the extreme. Everything is black, white, or gray, and almost nothing in between. And things that come there from other planes of existences, the color that they bring with them is often muted and just dimmed.
Just like sponged out.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. And anyone who's there for more than a few weeks begins to lose their color and their almost their sense of self. The place permeates dread and permeates death. Any plant life that there is often very sparse, often very deadly, because it is, you know, it's, you know, very thorny, very poisonous and stuff like that. And there's very little of it. And because of that, there's actually very little life at all in the Shadowfell.
Yeah, nothing's getting enough sun. It's like the ground just literally sucking the vitamin D right out of you.
Sun never shines in the Shadowfell. Uh-huh. It is always dreary.
Like my soul.
Yeah, yes, and like the souls of all the people stuck here. The Shadowfell is also known as the Plane of Shadow, and I didn't mention this in the Feywild episode, but the Feywild is also known as the Plane of Fairy. Just the only reason I say that is because the whole Feywild Shadowfell dichotomy didn't really come into existence in D&D until 4th edition.
Right, okay.
And before that, there was the Plane of Fairy and there was the Plane of Shadow, but it wasn't this dark and light mirror of the prime material rain plane warp thing going on. So just figured I'd say that. Now, here's a question. Is the Shadowfell inherently evil?
I don't think so.
To that, I would say kinda. I mean, in some ways, yes, in some ways, it is inherently tied to death. And quite frankly, in all my research, and not just research, and just all my experience when it comes to this fucking place, is that who rules here is really up for fucking debate. Because, like, in some iterations, it's the goddess of death, the Raven Queen. And she's got her own little, like, demiplane called Lathurna. And she rules a Shadowfell, and she's the god of like true neutrality. All souls that die have to come through the Shadowfell to Lutherna before she decides their ultimate fate. I've seen that. I've seen it where there are these beings, these very, very undescribed beings called the Dark Powers. And I would, the closest thing I would liken them to would be like Arcfey, like Archfey, but like,
yeah, yeah.
But like, they're so mysterious. They seem more powerful than even Archfey because they're responsible for certain things like, what's the word I'm looking for? I guess it's kind of a demiplane of Barovia, which is the Castle Ravenloft campaign setting, which we'll talk a little bit about here today, but that's in its own Atlas Exterus episode. But the Dark Powers are, they create these like different pocket dimensions, and they supposedly rule the Shadowfell.
Within
but, like,
the Shadowfell, different pocket dimensions.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yeah. You can only get to these pocket dimensions through the Shadowfell in the first place.
Gotcha. Okay.
It gets confusing. But,
for sure.
So I'm like, where do these guys, these unnamed powers fit into it if the goddess of death herself is kind of here? But then it gets even more confusing because the Raven Queen is often seen vying for power against the likes of certain demon princes like Orcus, or even certain gods like Vecna, who's like a god of necromancy. And Orcus is also, he's a ruler of undead.
She's trying to get with them?
No, she hates them.
Oh, she wants to murder them?
Yeah, she's like, fuck them. Like, the undeath. Undeath is against the natural order. All things must die. It is the way it must be.
It's Merktown in the Shadowfell.
Yeah, yeah, I would say so. And there's a lot of factions in the Shadowfell, and we'll get into that. So, like, again,
all vying for power.
All vying for power, but like, but are they? Like, Orcus, okay, so Orcus's cult is maybe in the Shadowfell, but he should be in the Abyss, which is his own Atlas Exterus.
Okay.
Yeah, so like I said, it's very confusing. And here's another thing, too, is the Shadowfell...
where it's not supposed to be.
Yeah, the Shadowfell is... The Shadowfell is wrought with undead. There's so much undead stuff going on here, which makes, to me personally, no sense since the Queen of Death, who hates undeath, rules here.
Yeah.
So, who really rules the Shadowfell? I don't fucking know.
Well, it's kind of weird that, like... Not weird. I like the version D&D put together of undead, which is to say, you know, ghosts are undead.
They are.
Yeah, and that's not, like, typically, like, I think of zombies or, like...
Yeah.
Like kind of more like a physical, fleshy thing when I think of an undead, like a skeleton or something like that.
Yeah.
Skeletons are also undead.
They are. And I understand that. I understand that completely. And I think most of the time when people generally say the undead, they are talking about the more fleshy versions of the undead.
Right.
But there are more than that. There's wraiths, there's specters, there's ghosts.
Yeah.
There's a lot of incorporeal
stuff.
Those
are all like supernatural.
Supernatural. It's all supernatural D&D.
I draw the split. Like before I got to D&D, those things were split. Ghosts were one thing, and like zombies were another thing,
and they are another, but they do fall under the broader category of undeath and necromancy and all that stuff.
Okay,
but yeah, so the Shadowfell is wrought with this stuff. So okay, we talked about the Feywild and how it intersects with the Prime Material Plane.
Yes, and I think of that as like big ellipses.
Okay, that so like kind a Venn of diagram. Like,
yeah, they kind of split. Like the tip of one might come out of another. Or like it might intersect more like along its wider part of it.
So
like some more area is affected, like a bubble.
I that's a good metaphor. Unfortunately, like it doesn't quite capture the way it really is, because like the way it really is it doesn't make sense to like normal physics. So it's hard to describe on a pen and paper. It's a good metaphor.
Yeah,
it's a good analogy.
I'm, like kind of thinking about it as a world build.
Yeah,
like,
and
there
often,
are places affected by it.
And oftentimes it is drawn exactly how you're describing. More like if you pictured the Prime Material Plane as like an oval, and then you would have two perpendicular ovals that slightly intersected on that oval.
Yeah.
But like, even though like that's a good like visual, that's not really the way it is, because like the way it's supposed to be is like these layers are literally on top of each other at all times.
Yes. Okay.
And the only way they're ever able to intersect are when certain key locations are similar enough in both planes that they become one.
Right. Okay. Yeah. That makes sense to me.
Yeah. So while the Feywild often had Fey crossings in places of like nature or like beautiful mountain peaks, stuff like
that.
Like certain standing stones.
Like the Amazon rainforest would be like Feywild.
Yeah. Exactly. Shadow crossings are usually found in like swamps or crypts or cemeteries. ancient battlefields where a lot of people died, and other like gloomy places throughout the world.
Yeah.
Very shadowy some places.
Places that never see the sun.
Exactly. Places that never see the sun.
See death.
Exactly. So those are the places that you find shadow crossings. And we talked about how like it, from there are other crossings into other demiplanes, and those are created by the things called the dark powers.
Okay.
So the sun never shines, not a lot of plant life. The landscape is usually like grim stone, like just plains of death, or like great mountains with jagged black peaks and whatnot. In our world, there might just be a mountain. But in the Shadowfell, that mountain will be like black, jagged, no life on it, and maybe even like the peak will resemble like that of a skull.
Yeah,
just,
okay.
Just to add that little cheese
dark,
on top.
Some dark stuff.
It's just so inherently dark that skull mountains appear. And and it's inherently a place of despair, not just because of all these nasty, ugly things, but it permeates the air. And like when a player character goes to the Shadowfell, they literally once a day have to make a wisdom save to fight off Shadowfell despair.
That's cool.
And
that's almost like exhaustion.
It's almost like exhaustion, and it can leave you feeling apathetic. It can make you feel hopeless and suicidal, and it can even drive you to madness, depending on how bad you roll.
How do you handle that as a DM? Like when
there are literal rules in
the
DMG.
That's right. You're right. There are.
So what happens is the player has to roll. I think it's against a 10 wisdom save. So it's a pretty low, but when you got to do it every day,
yeah,
like it adds up.
It's hard because like there needs to be rules for that, because like a player character is like who's never been insane, hopefully,
right?
Like,
well, let's hope.
How would they let me try to role play this?
Yeah, you
or
do,
like who would
you
want
do what
to
you can.
The
there
DM
are
would be
there
like,
are
you must be insane now.
Yeah, I would say one good way to do it is in the Rage of Demons adventure that D&D came out with, I think it was last year or the year before that, there are literal insanity rules because it's part of the campaign. Like the demon princes are amongst the mortals and their presence is driving people crazy.
Oh shit.
Yeah. And that, so I would look there for ideas, although those insanity charts might be a little too extreme for the madness that the Shadowfell might give you, but that's a place to look if you have that module. Other than that, there are some rules in the DMG that tells you like if they fail a save, you roll a d6, and depending on what you roll, a certain effect happens to the player character.
Cool.
Now, it doesn't get touched on in the DMG that much, but I've seen this in literal Forgotten Realms books written about characters in the Shadowfell, and the Shadowfell despair thing can fucking kill you. And it can more than just kill you. It can decimate you into nothingness. You will seep into shadow and fail to exist anymore if you give yourself over to the despair of the Shadowfell too far.
That sounds terrible.
It is terrible. And that gets us into... it's really bad. And it gets us into a discussion on one of the most... you become like this black shadowy dust and basically
oh,
ash,
that's like literal.
And you're nothing.
Oh, dang.
Yeah. And this gets us onto like probably the most common denizen outside of the undead of the Shadowfell, and that's a people called the Shadar Kai.
Right.
Who there isn't an official racial template for, but I have made my own homebrew one because it's one of my favorite races. And we have one in our game now.
Yes.
And we had one in the game I was running, and hopefully we get back to that game one of these days. But Shadar Kai are very interesting.
Yes, they are. So, I like them. They're very, very fun to roleplay with.
Yes, yeah. And being one is very interesting as well. So Shadar Kai are...
Oh, I got to stop you there. Shout out to Josh Freeland.
Oh, yes. Our favorite Shadar Kai.
Right on.
The Shadar Kai are humanoids. I think the story goes that they were a tribe of humans that worshipped the Raven Queen, and they feared death, and so they asked the Raven Queen to cure them of this fear of death. And
okay. She
did so by teaching them to 100% accept death as part of life, and this and that. And they were so loyal to her, she brought them into the Shadowfell with her to live and to kind of be her servants. And I've seen that, you know, shown in certain like D&D settings, but I've also seen where they're not so reverent to her, they're not so like attached to her, and they kind of form like these tribes that kind of roam the Shadowfell and You know, they wage war on each other a lot. And here's the thing. So the thing about the Shadowfell or the Shadowkai is like they've been exposed to the Shadowfell for so long that falling into Shadowfell despair is a daily battle for them. Like every minute of every hour of every day. And the only way to fend it off is to keep the adrenaline going, keep the excitement going, make sure that whatever they're doing, they're feeling something in the moment.
Get that rush.
And that has led to incredibly bizarre society where it is the societal norm to seek out pain, like inflicting self-mutilation, inflicting pain on others, extreme sexual promiscuity, an insane amount of like piercings and tattoos. They're all fighters. They all know how to fight, and they fight regularly. It's a very vicious, very thrill-seeking society, and the reason they do it is so that they don't suffer a fate worse than death.
Right. And they don't just self-inflict pain, they inflict pain on each other and others.
Yes, exactly. And they're they're often very brutal.
Careful.
Yeah, indeed. Jesus, going to fall down on the
super
podcast.
Super chair let's malfunction.
See if I can fix this situation. No, that didn't do it.
You got to push the bar.
Yeah, I did it. So it leads to a society of people that are, I would say, incredibly barbaric, incredibly vicious, incredibly cruel, and constantly obsessed with death.
Yes.
And
In
this place of death. Other things that live in the Shadowfell besides like the undead and Shadowkai are Shadowborn, which are basically anybody who, like any race that ends up in the Shadowfell and ends up stuck there. Because oftentimes if you end up in the Shadowfell, it's very hard to get out.
Yeah,
get
stuck in these planes for
yeah,
a while.
Yeah, so dwarves, elves, halflings, humans, they get stuck in the Shadowfell and end up living there and are born there and die there. They're called the Shadowborn. And there's nothing really mechanical out there for them. But there's some role play stuff that I would definitely encourage someone who is Shadowborn to do, because your society is going to be a lot different than it normally would be.
Would it be more like how the Shadowkai are? Or is it unique to each?
It's just generally more grim. It's not going to be like the Shadowkai because they're not. The Shadowkai are so suffused with shadow that they're constantly on edge of just the scale tipping just that much for them to dissipate into shadow.
Yeah.
So like the Shadowborn aren't there yet, but theoretically, the Shadowborn eventually will become like the Shadowkai once they're there long enough as a people.
So. We're having some technical difficulties, and we're going to have to take our short rest a little early here.
Are we? Okay. Yes. Let's do it.
All right.
Short rest time. Everybody, this is the part of the show where we stop everything just to say thank you, and we are thanking you for listening in and for supporting us. We really appreciate it. If you want to help us out even more, if you're listening to us on your podcast app, maybe go check us out on YouTube. Subscribe there. If you're checking us out on YouTube, maybe go download us on a podcast app and subscribe there. Leaving reviews is also very helpful. Like, subscribe, and of course, the most important thing that you possibly do to help us out is to just share us. You know,
tell your friends. You know somebody that might like the show? Let them know that the Dungeoncast is out there and doing it big D&D style for all of you.
Yeah, absolutely.
At least we hope. Trying. Yeah,
we're doing our best, and we're having a blast doing it. And I love talking about this stuff. I honestly would be talking about this stuff anyway, so it's kind of nice to organize it, structure it, and put it in show format. I really like it.
Yeah, it's been a good time. We're on soundcloud.com/thedungeoncast. Mm-hmm. We're on anywhere that you can get podcasts, really.
Mm-hmm.
We're on that good YouTube, getting our video games straight. I'm trying to get my my video game straight. Had me a little hiccup just a bit ago.
Right. And if you did originally check out some of her stuff on YouTube but didn't like the video format, you might want to go check it out again because it is greatly improved since our early days of doing this. I would say we put a lot of effort into it. So check it out.
Trying to improve every week. That's what it's all about here on the Dungeoncast. And like we said, tell your friends, let them know that we got a show for them, hopefully. Mm-hmm. But I think that's it. We're not saying anything. Anybody we got to shout out? Shout out to Sandy getting that hard sign-off idea. You know, always shout out to Sandy. He's always coming up clutch.
Yep, absolutely.
And shout out to Rosden.
Oh, yeah, of course.
A.K.A. Josh Freeland.
Yep.
A.K.A. Digo.
Yep. All right, guys. I think we're all rested up. Yeah. I've shaken off my Shadowfell despair, and I'm ready to go.
Let's go back to the show.
Are you good?
Yes, we are good. We have returned.
All right.
I've gotten my things straight.
Mm-hmm.
And let's do it.
All right. Well, before the rest, we were talking about the people or things and people that live in the Shadowfell. Shatterkai, Shadowborn. Also things called shades, and I'm sure you're seeing a freaking trend here with sh words. But
some nasty plants too.
We'll get to that. So shades are interesting because they are humanoid beings that at some point in their life gave a piece of their soul,
yes,
to have Shadowfell powers.
It's interesting. I threw some shades at you guys when I.
How do you know about these shades, Brian? Tell me.
They're really cool. I really liked reading about them in the monster manual.
They were
one of my favorite little out of the pool of things I was trying to select from. I had the most fun with choosing them.
Right. Well, then you probably know that when they give a part of their soul to be infused with shadow, it does something to their mind and their heart and their soul, where it makes them have wicked thoughts and do wicked things. And believe it or not, 4th edition actually introduced the shade as a playable character race, which is weird. And
that's kind of like a drow, huh?
I'd say it's a lot worse than a drow, because like shades should be pretty inherently evil. I kind of like the idea of like maybe you did it because you had to, and you're constantly fighting the evil within you. I kind of like that take on it, but like other than that, you know,
that's a pretty special circumstance.
You got evil infused into your soul. What do you want? Like, I'm sorry, guy, you're probably gonna be pretty bad. So,
bad mouth feel.
Yeah, exactly. So there are shades, and they dwell in and out of the Shadowfell as well. Hags can make their lives there, even though hags are traditionally fey creatures. There are night hags that, although are still traditionally fey, they sometimes live there. I've read books of hags in the Shadowfell. So.
Hags are the baby stealers, right?
They do steal babies, but they do a lot of other things. They're witches. They are inherently ugly. Like, ugliness, it's not a subjective thing with them. They are objectively supposed to be attributed the most ugly attributes known to man.
That hook nose with the warts on it. Mm-hmm. The wrinkles.
They're all wrinkles and warts and nastiness, and they smell, and they live yucky lives. And that'll be a nice monster mythos episode to do. I like hags. They're scary. They're fucking scary. Yeah.
It's always fun in D&D to describe how things smell.
Yeah. Yeah, it comes up more often than you think.
Yeah.
Or maybe just as often as you'd think. But
you smell that nasty poop garbage.
Yeah, there's a lot of nasty smelling things in D&D. So Shadowhounds are a fun thing that live in the Shadowfell, and they're pretty self-explanatory. They're like shadow wolves, or wolves infused with shadow. They're like the Shatterkai of wolves.
It's like there you go. Yeah, okay. It's like a hellhound.
Kinda, and
just
much like
Shadowhound.
Much like hellhounds, shadowhounds are kind of portrayed as like these big, burly, mastiff-looking things.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is cool, but I also like the idea of them being like sleek and fast. Because a lot of things in the Shadowfell, for some reason or another, are very sleek, fast, and stealthy.
Yeah, it's a very dexterity kind of oriented area.
Yeah, it is. Like shades, Shatterkai,
stealthy.
Nightmares are another thing that live here. I don't know if you know what a nightmare is, Brian.
I do. I think so.
You know what a nightmare is? Tell me what a nightmare is, Brian.
I know that it's not like a good dream.
Well, yeah. It's not one of those good dreams, though.
No, it's like a ghost, right? Like
no.
What was it? Wasn't it like dressed like a person with like kind of dreadlocky things? I'm thinking of the wrong thing.
Well,
that's
okay,
the white.
Okay, I know where you're coming from. So you're talking about the mythological nightmare. The demon that like sits on your chest and paralyzes you and forces you to have a bad dream.
Nope.
Or maybe that's not what you're talking about.
Nope. Guess I don't know.
Okay. So you have no idea what a nightmare is.
Well, I feel I was in the monster manual. I definitely saw
it.
It
is definitely in the monster manual.
Yeah.
And it is in the shape of a horse. It's a horse of fire and shadow.
It was probably too strong.
Yes, they're very powerful.
Yeah.
They're very powerful. And but they do also roam the Shadowfell. I actually read a really cool book where a Shatterkai formed an alliance with a nightmare, and they helped each other out against this hag, and it's a really cool book.
Now I know. I remember now. I imagine the horse that Ichabod Crane would ride.
Yes, you mean the Headless Horseman, but yes.
Oh, yeah, in the story with Ichabod Crane.
Yes.
Where am I today?
It's all good, man. The Shadowfell will do that to you. So, Shadowhounds, undead, hags, nightmares, all these nasty, nasty things. But it gets a little bit nastier because this is also a place where shadow dragons make their home.
Nice.
Or it's more a place that dragons live sometimes for whatever fucking reason they decide to.
Become shadow dragons
yeah. over time because the magic coalesces with the magic of the dragons, and a part of it gets onto a part of them, and they just become
part of you imprinted onto
exactly.
me.
Exactly. And thus a shadow dragon is born, and they're usually just the dragon on steroids with like extra necrotic stuff going on, necrotic resistances, super stealth, and maybe even teleportation going on. There's a template in the monster manual, and it's very scary.
Yes, I've looked at it, and I decided if I use one in our game,
yeah.
that it's going to be its personality is going to be based off of Hugo Weaving.
I like it.
From The Matrix.
Of course. Mr. Smith, the dragon. I like it. Okay, so that's... and then, of course, the undead. And the undead is a broad term like we discussed, but like generally what I see is a lot of ghosts.
Yeah.
A lot of like lost souls, if you will, on their way to Latherna.
I like that.
It is cool. But there's also a lot of necromancers, a lot of vampires, ghouls, the zombies, I guess whites, because zombies, whites, ghouls, and ghasts, they all kind of fall in the same fucking
category.
Yeah,
yeah.
And pretty much any undead. But believe it or not, in this sparsely populated, horrible, horrible plane of existence, there are actually cities that do exist.
I was going to ask, do people like build homes in the Shadowfell?
There are cities. And
there has to be if you're how like, they got there, running a tribe.
Yeah, how they got there is a little interesting. Okay, so in Forgotten Realms, there's a city called Neverwinter, which okay. is probably, it's on the Sword Coast. There's even whole games just called Neverwinter.
I hear that name getting used yeah. often.
Yes, it's a very popular fantasy city, and it's a pretty cool place.
Does it snow?
No, I don't think so. I don't actually know that much about Neverwinter, I'm going to be honest. I'm not a Forgotten Realms fan.
I like how in Adventure Zone it did.
Did it snow in Neverwinter?
What was it, Crystal Kingdom, when they were looking down at it at the moon from the moon base? I think.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, that was a Christmas season. Well, Neverwinter has a mirror city in the Shadowfell called Evernight, and it is a city of undead.
Oh, okay.
And
I don't think I've heard of that one.
Yeah, it's not too widely known about. I'd say the most popular city in Shadowfell is Gloomrot, which we'll talk about in a second. But Evernight is a city of undead. It is usually like beat to hell. Like almost like it's a city in as much as maybe at one point it was a city, but now it's just like ruined down.
Okay.
But there are denizens there, and they're usually like vampires or necromancers dabbling in dark magic, cultists of Orcus and stuff like that. And it is actually ruled, get this, by a noble class of ghouls that rule this city.
Okay.
Which is, I think, awesome. Ghouls. That's like really cool. Cause
are we talking like, because I know the medieval setting is usually more popularized, more popular in D&D. So mm-hmm. are we talking about like a castle to city? Like with walls
with
around
walls,
it.
It's okay. a city. It's just like run down, really.
Not like
really
modern,
poorly.
Not like skyscrapers and like old traffic lights. Okay.
God no. What?
Yeah,
no.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, no. It's all fantasy. All medieval. Medieval. So yeah, you know, it's a city like that, and it's
so I like the concept of like this once like great mm-hmm. civilization that's like almost kind of been gutted and is mm-hmm. rotting out. You know, like
yeah.
Like how like L.A. would be if you just kind of trashed the place and got rid of all the people.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this place is like that, but as if like it was a great city of long ago that happened to.
Yeah.
Right. It's not like a modern city that got gutted.
Right. Okay.
But yeah, it's this noble class of ghouls. And I just think that's interesting because ghouls, although traditionally are smarter, they're like sentient compared to like zombies. I've never really seen them like presented as that intelligent. I just think it's kind of a cool idea. So another city in Shadowfell is a city called Gloomrot, which is probably the most popular of the cities, so the most well-known city in the Shadowfell, and like a lot of Shadowborn live there. It's like an actual running economy, like an actual
okay.
city, and it's ruled by like a nobleman, and like there's lords and whatnot, and probably the most common people that live there are Shadarkai. But one of the cool things about this place is there are these demonic looking gargoyle things called the Keepers.
Oh, cool.
And no one
that
knows
awesome.
What they are. No one knows where they came from. But what they do is they upkeep the city. And they serve no one.
They like repair the roads?
They do, but they also, okay, so this city.
This fucking dark, mysterious, statuesque figure comes to life and like grabs a shovel and a wheelbarrow
and
like starts. Yeah, sure. It flies over to a wheelbarrow and wheels it over to like a pothole and just starts filling it.
Yeah, sure. That'd be hilarious. I like that. But no, the city is also ever changing.
Okay.
Like, buildings rise and fall, disappear, roads change, everything's different from day to day, and it's the Keepers doing this.
Yeah, they sound busy.
To whatever purpose it is they serve. No one knows who made them, no one knows who they serve, no one knows why it is they do what they do, but they do it anyway.
Is that what it says, like in their lore? Mm-hmm. Like in their...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There it is.
And nobody knows.
And nobody knows. There's a lot of that when we get into this more fringe stuff in D&D.
Maybe when we read Yawning Portal, it'll have something on that.
Maybe. That's more like dungeon exploration stuff, but who knows? We'll see. The third city I want to talk about in the Shadowfell is a city I read about in Forgotten Realms. It's called Ikemu or Ikemu. I think it's Ikemu. And it is an interesting city because it rides on a border of a shadow crossing.
Okay.
Half the city exists in the Underdark of the Prime Material Plane, and the other half exists in the Shadowfell.
Okay.
And now, I like the city a lot because, unlike the other two cities, which are really shitty places to live, this place is actually pretty okay, and it's very, very well organized, and the Shadarkai that live here are exceptionally different from Shadarkai that are shown in other places throughout, like, D&D.
Okay.
It's because these Shadarkai are more civilized, and they've learned to develop a society that doesn't rely on the horrible society of self-mutilation and violence and promiscuous sex and violent acts and all this stuff. And the way they do that is they find a greater purpose in religion. And specifically...
Oh, shit.
Specifically, they are aligned with the god Tempest, who is a neutral deity of like war and battle and whatnot.
Okay, so they're not really trying to get in with the Raven Queen.
No, as a matter of fact, the Raven Queen doesn't exist in Forgotten Realms.
Oh,
like,
okay.
She is a strictly 4th edition D&D kind of deity. She's really cool. She's one of my favorite deities, and we'll do an episode on her one day. But no, these guys align themselves with Tempest. And Tempest is a pretty cool deity because he really is neutral. He's not like about waging war, but he is about like the fight and like military stuff. And it keeps them military. It keeps them, it gives them purpose. And that purpose gives them drive and it keeps them from fading into the Shadowfell.
Yeah.
And a lot of the, like what they, there's a lot of trade that goes on here because like the Underdark, even though we haven't talked about it a lot, like there's a lot of bad stuff down there, but there are cities and there are like trade routes.
Yeah,
and
like civilizations like exist.
Yeah, so
there
like,
are gnomes.
So yeah, so traders come to this place. Like it's got a flowing economy.
Fuck, man. And they gotta take my route down to fucking, what was it called again?
Ikemu.
I gotta take my route down to Ikemu.
And I know, right?
Wish me luck.
I know, right? And the city's actually, because it's split in half, like only Shadarkai are allowed on the Shadowfell side of things.
So it's split like right down the middle?
Yeah.
So Shadarkai aren't limited where they can go.
They can go wherever. They rule the city.
But they're like, you stay out.
Yeah.
Don't fucking cross this line, though.
Exactly.
We'll kill you.
Yeah, we'll kill you. And they will. I don't know. I thought it was cool. I thought it was a cool way to like show that the Shadarkai don't have to be so crazy.
Yeah, like living in like a tribe in the wild, mm-hmm. like I don't know, what are they doing all the time, like fucking cutting themselves and like going up on rocks and fucking,
well, yeah, there's a lot of that. There's a lot of all that. So one of the things I read in this
for
book
sure.
which the name of this book is eluding me. I think it was either Unbroken Chain or Breaking the Chains, something to do with chains, because the main guy fought with chains, with spike chains.
It wasn't called Eluding Me?
No.
Sorry, that's a bad joke.
No. God, Brian. All right. And in this book, there is a quote-unquote execution of a Shadarkai. Not a public one, but it is not an execution, but it's totally an execution. And it's with a very sympathetic character, and it's actually a really sad moment. And basically...
Like a planned, are we talking like a planned assassination?
No,
here?
This is an execution. So it's public in as much like about how a beheading is public. That's literally in front of people. Like it's public in as much as someone getting the electric chair is public. So not, but
scheduled.
It's scheduled And it's scheduled. Decided by court. Yeah, scheduled. And decided by a court or by ruling law, and like everyone knows. And so this guy, it was a political execution. Like the leader didn't want to do it, but he kind of had to do it to save face. And it's this really fucked up situation. But like he leaves himself this really sly out of guilt, which is really shitty, where basically if the person who's guilty, who I can't remember his name right now, was not guilty, Tempest would give him a protection. And like, okay, if his faith in Tempest was strong enough, he would be okay. And this is what they did to him. Because remember everything I said about how it works with Shatterkai, is they chained him to a chair in an empty dark room and blindfolded him.
For sure.
For 9 days straight.
For sure.
They kept giving them food and water. Do you remember what happens?
Sounds like the Shadowfell.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you remember what happens to Shatterkai if they're not stimulated?
Yeah, they'll fall into the despair.
Exactly. And like, it was a death sentence. There was no way he was going to make it. And you literally have to read through like day by day. And I think it's by day 7, he gives up. And like, oh, when they come to get him, he's gone.
Oh,
it was really fucked up. I was like, no, this is horrible. But yeah, so Shatterkai, no joke. Shadowfell, no joke. And I don't know, you got any questions about Shadowfell?
Like, how would you happen upon it, like you would the Feywild?
Yeah, it can totally happen like that.
Okay, so
it's very much like the Feywild.
You're walking through some caves or something, and you're just like, oh, God, shit. Like,
what a horrible day.
I feel very sad all of a sudden. Yes. There's everything.
Yeah, suddenly you're just really depressed. Yeah,
I
no.
Think you, that fucking plant is trying to eat my shoe.
No.
Like that kind of thing?
That just might be madness at that point.
Yeah. Although, well, you said there was like foliage that would like attack you.
There is. Okay, so there are like blights, which they're in the Monster Manual, and they're like plant life that like can take like a humanoid form and it's inherently evil.
See.
So
okay.
Sometimes you'll see that, but like the plant life is wicked in as much as like, so I was reading, I think it, well,
like Venus flytrappy kind of, is that what we're talking?
No, okay, so like it's kind of silly if you ask me, but in the DMG it says like the plant life is wicked in as much as like, as travelers are like traveling through brush, like the branches will catch their clothing and like tug at them and stuff, and it's just like, it's like this seemingly evil thing. It's not actually, though.
It's just annoying.
It's just annoying and like trying to grab you and drag you to your death, but unable to because it's a
this
fucking
place
tree.
Is slightly more troublesome than everywhere else.
Yes, it's, exactly. Another thing to talk about is there are these mists that roam around the Shadowfell called the Shadow Mists, and sometimes they're controlled by the Raven Queen, and sometimes the Dark Powers. I don't know. When the Raven Queen uses it, she can literally use it to, like, she sends her Shadow Mist to the normal mortal plane and can grab shit and bring it to her.
Ooh.
Also, they just kind of roam the Shadowfell.
Okay.
The Dark Powers, I've seen use the Shadow Mists to siphon away these demi-planes of existence, including Barovia, which is surrounded by these Shadow Planes, which you cannot escape.
Is that one of those pockets?
It is a pocket dimension, yeah.
Okay.
It is an entire region of the Prime Material Plane that got sucked into the Shadowfell because of some bullshit that went down. And Baron, Strahd von Zarevich, that's his name.
Colorful.
Yeah, he's basically Dracula. And, okay. And I mean, he really is.
Nosferatu, he's Dracula?
No, he's like... like Dracula, like he's not like sexy Dracula. He's not Nosferatu Dracula either, though.
He's not Joey Tribbiani Dracula.
I don't know who that is.
The guy from Friends.
No, what?
Never mind.
Okay. God, your fucking references. Anyways, that'll be in a different episode. But Barovia is surrounded by the Shadow Mist, and no one.
Sorry, I thought you were talking about Joey Tribbiani Dracula for a second. I was like, I thought you said you didn't know what that is.
I don't.
Never mind.
I don't.
Go back to the other.
I just
thing.
Said it's not Nosferatu.
Okay.
Okay.
So it's like a more like, okay, Castlevania Dracula?
Yes, there we go. Okay. It's super Castlevania, except for way scarier than Castlevania, if you ask me. Although Castlevania is really cool.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Barovia is surrounded by these Shadow Mists, and if the Dark Powers or if Strahd himself don't want you to escape, you're never leaving Barovia, ever. You're stuck there. And Barovia will suck in people both from the Shadowfell or even from the Prime Material Plane.
Just randomly.
Not randomly. The Dark Powers, they decide who comes and goes.
Reach out and touch you. Real bad.
Yeah, in a big bad way.
No.
Okay, so that's basically all I got to say about the Shadowfell off the top of my head.
Can we talk about, are there planes of existence that intersect with each other? Like, would the Shadowfell and the Feywild ever, have this weird kind of, compete going on, maybe? Or, a mix-up? Or
I don't really see that. I see them as being very far away from each other.
Okay, yes.
Despite, being both connected to the same realm of existence.
They're on the same... The way I'm seeing it is, it's on the same spectrum, a spectrum of light. And one is over here with all the color, and one is their grayscale, on the
other. Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. I very rarely see Shadowfell and Fae stuff get intermingled, despite them being so related to each other.
Because they're so different.
Because they're so vastly different. Actually, funny thing, the Shadow Kai came about as a alternative or Shadow Fae to what are the Eladrin, which we'll have to talk about one of these days.
Yeah,
and there are a lot of, there's a lot of similarities in abilities, but that's about it.
Okay.
Everything else is drastically different.
And I do have one more question. It's when you are, I want to separate the reality from the homebrew here. Is Misty Step, in your homebrew, Misty Step is something a Shatter Kai can do a one a day?
Kinda? Yes.
And is that
once every short rest? Same with the Eladrin. Yes. Yeah.
So is that something that carries over into Shatter Kai lore, in D&D fiction?
Yes, it does. Shatter Kai definitely have that. Sometimes they have the ability to become incorporeal for a moment.
That's really cool.
Is really cool. Sometimes they can literally teleport. I ran a Shatter Kai hybrid ranger cleric. In 4th edition, it was so much fun, and I took a feat that transformed what was my Shadow Jaunt, which is what you know as Misty Step in 5th edition,
right,
and made it so that I could literally, rather than just teleport, 30 feet, I could teleport something 100 feet by stepping into one shadow and stepping out of another.
That's cool.
I was this is dope. Yeah,
that reminds me of that. I think it's Bard stuff or Druid stuff. It might be Druid stuff, where in Critical Role, I know they teleport through trees.
Oh, that's cool.
One guy can go through a tree and just go. Does that place have trees?
Right.
I got us.
That's very much that reminds me of Game of Thrones when it comes to the old gods and stuff.
Show?
No, they don't, but I'm not going to get into it.
Okay.
Yeah. You need to watch Game of Thrones is all I got to say.
I guess.
Yes. No, you do. Definitely.
Jamie says I should read Game of Thrones.
Don't. I mean, dude, I'm going to say don't. The books are okay. I like the books, and I know that's blasphemous, and I probably just pissed off everybody who listens to the show, but I do, honest to God, this is the one occasion where I actually like the show better. I don't know why, but I read the first 3.5 books. I actually couldn't make it through book 4. I read a lot of fantasy. I couldn't make it through book 4. It just wasn't keeping me there.
Listeners of this podcast / video, go into the comments and tell me what I should do. Should I Game of Thrones at all? And if I am going to Game of Thrones, should I read or watch?
I would say watch. Just me. I mean, they can tell you what they're going to tell you. I would say watch just to save you some fucking time, because I already know how pressed for time you tend to be.
Tweeted us.
Let us know.
Watch.
Tell Brian how to live his life.
Please. You have permission. I do have. I can take books with me.
That's true.
Download books on my cellular device.
There you go. Yeah.
We'll see. I don't know. You let me know. Tweet at us or something.
But you were saying about tree teleportation.
Yep, I was.
Oh, okay. That's it. All right. Well, do you have any
more
questions?
That just reminded me of that. Sorry.
Anything else going on? Any other Shadowfell inquiries?
Did I have...
Sometimes you'll find demons in the Shadowfell, but
That makes sense.
It's not traditional. It doesn't really. If you know as much about the planes as I do, it doesn't make that much sense.
Well, I could see a demon just going in there and not really being fucked up by it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Oh, yeah. Demons are not... Demons, devils, any fiends, they're not going to be affected by the Shadowfell Despair. They don't give a fuck. No way.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it makes as much sense as there are a lot of Orcus cultists there, and I know Orcus wants to make the Shadowfell his... Which is funny because he already owns a few planes of existence in the Abyss. But death, Orcus wants to rule death. And since death, the Shadowfell are so inherently tied together, his cultists are there trying to take over a lot of the time. I guess they would summon demons a lot. So I guess that makes sense. So, because, Orcus is going to rule over an entire army of demons. But
this guy sounds cool. I don't really know anything
about him. He's scary as shit. Yeah. Like we haven't gotten into anything nearly as dark as the demons and the abyss. Like, that shit is gnarly.
Sweet. Yeah. Okay.
But since we're so far off subject, I think we've ran out of things to talk about when it comes to Shadowfell.
Yeah, for now.
For now.
So, let's call it a game.
Let's call it a game.